This is Old Testament Premium Podcast number 33, Jeroboam and Rehoboam. I bring you greetings from Georgia, where we're about to begin our annual teacher seminar on Why Do the Nations Rage? Gospel Solutions to Prejudice and Separation. I'm really looking forward to this seminar, to all the guest speakers who will be coming in, and just the chance to be stimulated in this way. Like you who are listening to the podcast, I'm looking for ideas. I'm looking for solutions. Always looking for things in God's Word I may have missed or misunderstood or worse, taught incorrectly. And it's just a wonderful privilege to have fellowship with people from different parts of the world, and calls me to really be my best for God. I wish you could be here at this seminar. Anyway, the purpose right now is to get into this podcast, Jeroboam and Rehoboam. I know they sound like they're brothers. They actually sound like they may be twin brothers. There's Jeroboam and Rehoboam, and maybe another one, a sister named Trixie Boehm. Really, there's no connection at all. They're not related. They are connected in a sense that they knew each other and they both reigned at the same time, but any other resemblance is coincidental. In fact, they're really different. They're at opposite ends of the leadership spectrum. If I were going to give a subtitle to this podcast, I might call it The Two Extremes or The Two Poles of Leadership. One is inflexible, the other guy is flexible. One's hardline, one's a little too easygoing, loose. One is trying to control everybody, and the other one lets everyone get out of control. Actually, they're both controlling in a sense. You'll see once we get in there. So we're going to be reading mainly from 1 Kings, and I'm going to begin in chapter 11, verse 26. Here we meet Jeroboam, who's a servant of Solomon, and we find that he's capable. Solomon is doing some building work, and this guy is capable. I think it's not just that he was good at building. He must have been good at administration. Let me read one verse. Now the man Jeroboam was capable, and Solomon noticed the young man because he was getting things done. Hey, so far so good. I would like someone to say, you're getting things done. That's good. What Solomon does then, he appoints him over the entire labor force of the house of Joseph. Well, when he says the house of Joseph, we're talking about a couple of the tribes. You may remember Joseph had two sons, so there's no tribe of Joseph. But his sons were Ephraim and Manasseh. And Ephraim and Manasseh, that accounts for a very large part of Israel. So Jeroboam is promoted to a position of responsibility. During that time, now I'm going to start reading in verse 29. The prophet Ahijah the Shilonite met Jeroboam on the road as Jeroboam came out of Jerusalem. Now Ahijah had wrapped himself with a new cloak, and the two of them were alone in the field. Then Ahijah took hold of the new cloak he had on, tore it into 12 pieces, and said to Jeroboam, "Take 10 pieces for yourself. For this is what the Lord God of Israel says. I am about to tear the kingdom out of Solomon's hand. I will give you 10 tribes, but one tribe will remain his because of my servant David and because of Jerusalem, the city I chose out of all the tribes of Israel." Let's just pause for a moment. Jeroboam is leaving the city of Jerusalem. Perhaps he had been working that day. At any rate, he is met, he's intercepted by a prophet. And the prophet dramatically shows him that he will become a new king, but not the king of all of Israel, just the king of most of Israel. And he symbolizes this by tearing his cloak into 12 pieces, 10 of which are for Jeroboam, and 2 of which will remain to the son of Solomon. And we'll come to him in a moment. This dramatic action is precedented. There are a number of places, you may be familiar with them, where something is torn or cut into multiple pieces and sent throughout Israel, or just chopped into pieces. I think it's kind of an interesting theme to explore. But the prophets often taught very dramatically. In this case, the guy's taking his new cloak, his clothes, and he's tearing them into pieces. Well, what's the problem? If we continued to read, we'd see the problem is that there's tremendous idolatry among the descendants of David. Although David was faithful and God loved him, Solomon turned away in his old age, and his descendants are not so faithful. And the passage continues to tell us specifically which gods they were worshiping, the gods and goddesses of the people. Anyway, the prophet says, I will humble David's descendants because of their unfaithfulness, but not forever. In other words, Jeroboam is being asked to step in and lead, partly as a punishment for God's people, partly because the other king, the alternate king, Rehoboam, wasn't going to deserve to be in leadership. Solomon, we see, tried to kill Jeroboam, but Jeroboam fled to Egypt, to Shishak, king of Egypt, where he remained until Solomon's death. Now, I fear at this point some listeners may be getting the names confused. So let's put this in historical context. It's 2,900 years ago. Solomon is on the throne, but at this point he's turned away from God. Maybe not entirely, but he's been influenced by the idolatrous religions of all those wives. So we had Saul, David, Solomon. He's the third king. Solomon has a son named Jeroboam. Solomon is still on the throne, though, when he hears that the prophet has told Jeroboam that Jeroboam will be king. Now, I don't know how much of that message got to Solomon, but he knew that this meant the end of, well, not necessarily the end of his dynasty, because that would continue, but the end of his dynastic control over Israel. And so he does the noble thing. He tries to assassinate Jeroboam. Look, I'm being a little tongue-in-cheek. It's amazing how far Solomon falls. So Jeroboam, and he's not the first one in Scripture, nor the last to do this, he flees to Egypt until it's safe. And then he returns. Okay, so Jeroboam is our first character. His name means the people contend. The people contend. Actually, it seems Jeroboam is the one who's contending, because this prophecy and the power that are entailed in the political promise go straight to his head. It's the people of God who are really contending with God.